Mike Attic.
Hey, Mike.
You know, there's this guy that was trying to get a job. He's sitting in front of a dude looking at his resume. Cat's looking at the resume, peeking over the top of it with these glasses, and said, "Man, I just don't know if you're what we're looking for. I don't know if you're responsible. I don't know if you're dependable." And the guy, in his best drunken voice, yeah, he showed up to the interview drunk, which is what we're prone to do sometimes. In his best drunken voice, he goes, "What do you mean I'm not dependable? For the last 5 years, I've had a $500 a day drug habit. I ain't missed a payment." And the truth of the matter is that the question was just asked, do we have what it takes? And the fact of the matter is that every single person in here, there is absolutely no doubt, including myself, have what it takes to make it here. Because I know what it feels like to be out there and do whatever I had to do to not miss that payment. And of course, this ain't about making payments, because we're well known for not making payments on time. This is about a concept of doing what I needed to do and having the energy to do what I wanted to do. I come in here with that amount of energy, ready to go. Now, what's the sad truth about it is very few, a small percentage of people choose to avail themselves of that energy. Now, maybe it's because nobody told them that it's sitting there waiting. Maybe they're used to hearing those voices from the past, like my father when I was 8 years old. He said, "Son, don't you know you fuck up more than you fix?" Mm-hmm. You know, and those damn voices and the ones that I say to myself with how I treat myself. I'm not worth the effort. But the truth of the matter is that I have to have people around me that tell me I'm worth the effort. I've got to stop those old voices. And the only way I'm going to stop them is not just saying they're a lie, is acting the opposite and proving in my life that they're a lie. So I've spent a long time in recovery proving my father wrong. But the voices can still be there. That's why I need to keep coming to these meetings. Because you stay away from here long enough, those old voices, I will begin to listen to them. You know, and here we're clean, you know, and it's a good thing. Clean means more than taking a shower. Clean means more than just being off the stuff, okay? Because our basic text talks about mere abstinence doesn't equal recovery. When somebody who's got some time like me says clean, that means I'm off the stuff and I've worked the steps and I've had a transformation of thought and attitude. It's no wonder I'm not got the voices of old and the dopes trying to tell me I want to use. I haven't heard that temptation in a long time. But life takes over, and I begin to be able to have things that I can do in life. In the basic text, it talks about lost dreams awaken, new possibilities arise. Well, the new possibilities can arise, but if I'm not willing to step up and do a damn thing about it, they never become reality. And what makes this thing work is you stay here for long enough and you come back in and you see some newcomers and you go, "You know what? I've been where you're at. I'm not there anymore. Let me show you what I did about it." And the operative word is action. I wish I could say it rubs off by osmosis, but those old ideas are tough, especially when I know what to expect out there. At least I know how to deal with the streets, if there is such a thing. I'm not bragging about that I was the toughest, baddest son of a bitch. Somebody's done more time. My 10 days in the city jail was 10 fucking days too long, okay? I do not have an Alabama inmate number. The point of the matter is that these steps tell me that I can get off this elevator if I'm willing to do something about it. I don't have to go down and do this shit for 60 fucking years. And believe me, we can do that. We are survivors. We will do 10 times more shit than anybody out there. You can't hardly kill us, although there's some shit going around now that will do just that. And it's hardly bullshit. But the thing about it is that I've got to change the way I'm looking at things. And it's so fucking hard. A long time ago, there was this cat after a meeting showing everybody his business card of his bail bondsman. Boy, this shit was on triple stock paper, colored, laminated. It was the best fucking business card I've ever seen in my life. He was showing everybody, "Man, I got the best bail bondsman you've ever seen. He's the best bail bondsman on the planet. This motherfucker will come at 4 a.m, you know, with a signature. Fuck a credit check." You know, he was going on and on. And everybody was like, "Really? Give me a card. God damn." And I was thinking, this is after a meeting. Where am I at? So I decided to stump you, boy. Threw a question at him, little curveball. I said, "Hey, what's better than the best bail bondsman on the planet?" dude stammered and hawed everybody at the table. They couldn't figure it out. They could not imagine anything better than what was on that card right there. Finally, he said, man, I don't know. What's better than the best bail bondsman on the planet? I said, not needing one. See, now I am that lawyer that in Liar, Liar, the dude says, hey, so-and-so fuck-ups wanting some legal advice. He grabs the phone and says, stop breaking the law, asshole. You know, that's the best legal advice I ever got. But it's going to take me the steps to do it. Let me tell you something, what the basic text talks about those old voices. And I understand how hard it is to break the cycle. But I'm here to tell you it can be done. Talks about it on 33 in the basic text. It says, do we really want to be rid of our resentments, our anger, our fear? Many of us cling to our fears, doubt, self-loathing, or hatred because there is a distorted security in familiar pain. It seems safer to embrace what we know than to let go of it for the unknown. And that is exactly what I'm talking about. Hell, I know all that other stuff, but you know what? I needed somebody to say, well, how's that fucking working for you, Mike? And I'd tell you that it wasn't working. But I wasn't willing to step out on faith and do something different. I must have thought it was working because, see, talk is cheap. My actions showed me I thought it was still working. But what I had to do is step out on faith here. Act the opposite of a lot of those defects. Do what my sponsor said do. Get in the literature. Go to meetings. Not just to sit and hope it will rub off by osmosis, but actually do something in my recovery. Act as if sometimes. And I'm here to promise you, in all these faces, I have no idea who you are. And there's nothing wrong with that, but it does tell me that the disease is still kicking ass out there. Do you feel me? You know, I hadn't had to wear a white armband on my wrist in a long time, but I had one. I was in Cottage 2, right up there with the rest of them. They done convinced me I was in the wrong fucking place because they was talking about I smoked up four families and two BMWs, tipped it up and smoked it down to the bumper. And I was thinking, shit, I ain't done a fraction of what I'm hearing. Maybe I am in the wrong place. No, you're in the right place regardless of how far you've gone down. I'm here to say that we can stop digging. And if that sounds good to you, there's a few things that people like Paul and some of the other old timers will tell you. Say, man, this stuff is so simple. We don't have to complicate it. I've had a spiritual awakening as the result of these steps, and I'll pass.